I don't like to be in this position asking for things and you know, answering to the American taxpayer on this. I think this is, but it's a sad story, but the American taxpayer, as I said, is already on the hook. And you know, here's the other thing I want to say to you, because it's so important. This is not about big financial institutions. Every American employer depends on money flowing through our financial system every day, not just to create new jobs, but to sustain and keep existing jobs. What we're playing with here is very important, and again, give us the tools we need to make this work.
You do agree that this is the best and the only way forward that you know of at this time?
Yes, I do believe this is our best shot.
Not only our best shot, it's we're going to make it work.
How long were you the CEO of Goldman Sachs?
The CEO of Goldman Sachs from May of 1999 until I left to come down here at the middle of 2006.
There was a long-standing relationship there between AIG and Goldman Sachs that you were well aware of, and that relationship continued after you left. Why did you allow Goldman to be reimbursed at 100 cents on a dollar? Why did you not weigh in on behalf of the taxpayer?
These poor taxpayers.
Taxpayer.
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 Mr. Taxpayer.
Taxpayer protection.
Protect the taxpayer. Protect the taxpayer.
With taxpayer money.
Taxpayer is already on the hook. Taxpayer already is going to suffer the consequences.
Taxpayers were screwed to the tune of $78 billion.
As I said on a number of occasions, I was very supportive of the rescue of AIG, because a failure of that company would have been disastrous.
Especially to Goldman Sachs.
Disastrous to the American people.
Subprime mortgages pooled and sold as securities became subject to explosive demand from investors around the world. They were wrongly viewed as a steal.
We've had a housing bubble. When the bubble bursts, there is disaster.
Get our money out on the street. In the new world that you created, we have to clean up.
Hundreds of billions of dollars that Americans invested in retirement accounts have evaporated.
We're losing 7,200 homes to foreclosure every day.
One executive bonus could build one school.
25 million people without jobs. The wealthiest 400 people own more wealth than the bottom 150 million Americans. And that gap is the greatest of any major country on earth.
But as tragic and lamentable is that the ensuing calamity was entirely foreseeable and preventable. This was no act of God.
Look, how would you look at the risk of a hurricane? The season after we had four hurricanes on the East Coast, which was absolutely extraordinary. Everyone's nervous as such, rates went up spectacularly. They're lower again.
Mr. Blankfein, I want to say this. Having sat on the board of the California Earthquake Authority, acts of God will exempt. These were acts of men.
This modern risk management paradigm held sway for decades. The whole intellectual edifice, however, collapsed in the summer of last year.
All the while, our financial regulators appeared to be unaware as they sat on the sidelines.
The Office of Risk Assessment, when I came to the SEC, had seven people. It has seven people now. It leaves open today, as we meet here, $58 trillion notional market in credit default swaps.
Who is the brilliant person who came and said, let's do credit default swaps? Find him. Fire him.
You basically legalize gambling.
Always was in the back of my mind whenever anybody proposed more regulation is, will this make the market work better or will it get in the way?
And yet at the same time we have growing inequality. Do you believe that this economy will recover where some people have so much and so many people have so little?
I don't necessarily know that the short-term recovery of the economy is crucially tied to it, although it would help to have broader base purchasing power.
Our view of the way an economy functions is not properly modeled. That is what I find most disturbing.
What is the current fiscal gap for the United States of America?
It's changing rather rapidly.
Give me a ballpark number.
We received your testimony about 20 minutes before the hearing began today. We need to get it from the SEC earlier than 20 minutes before a hearing.
Ballpark is fine. Give me a number.
Well, the scoring up to the ballpark is rather enlarged.
So you don't know. It's the last report said $54 trillion.
I just say to our captains of the universe who are sitting here before us, I would like to know if any of you, since you received TARP money, increase the amount of interest on the credit cards. Did any of you do that?
First of all, I feel more like corporal of the universe, not captain of the universe at the moment. But
did you increase your credit card interest rate? If so, would you just raise your hand? Thank you.
I would also like to say something about the airplane that was in the news. We did not adjust quickly enough to this new world. In the end, I canceled delivery. Let me be clear with the committee. I get the new reality, and I will make sure Citi gets it as well.
Raise your hand if your company currently owns or leases a private plane.
I noticed in your comments you ad hoc, if you will, regarding the bazooka.
And the bazooka, you all can be darn glad you gave us the bazooka, because we needed it.
The theory behind the bazooka was that if you have a bazooka in your pocket and the markets know that you have it, you will never have to use it.
More is needed. We saw market turmoil reach a new level last week and spill over into the rest of the economy. We must now take further decisive action to fundamentally and comprehensively address the root cause.
The root. The root cause.
The root cause.
The root cause.
The root cause
of the root cause. The root cause of this, of course, is housing.
And the root cause is a housing correction, as you've all pointed out, which has resulted in illiquid assets, illiquid assets,
and illiquid,
illiquid assets.
Illiquid assets.
We must address this problem and restore confidence in our financial markets and financial institutions.
Financial institutions.
The financial system. The financial system.
System.
The financial industry.
Financial markets.
And the financial services industry.
The financial system.
And our financial system.
Thank you. Now I'll take several questions. Yes.
Can you give me a clearer black and white definition of what a financial institution is?
Congressman, I can't. We have a broad definition. We got very broad authorities and powers, and I think that's appropriate.
This massive bailout is not a solution. It is a financial socialism, and it's un-American. And I'm going to have to answer to the 4.2 million people in Kentucky if this plan does not work. And I am frightful to the point of almost panic that I don't see a solution in your plan.
If approved in its current form of $700 billion, this plan will cost every man, woman, and child in this country $2,300. This plan will come with an enormous cost and enormous risk.
I believe that our free market and our capitalistic society is at stake. And I'm not trying to be overdramatic, but it rests on you. So please, get it right.
There's a table on page 26, which consists of your balance sheet, central bank liquidity swaps, which shows an increase from $24 billion to $553 billion in change. So who got the money?
To financial institutions in Europe and other countries.
Which ones?
I don't know.
The Constitution says no money shall be drawn from the Treasury but in consequence of appropriations made by law. Do you think it's consistent with the spirit of that provision of the Constitution to hand out $500 billion to foreigners?
Congress approved it in the Federal Reserve Act.
When was that?
The Federal Reserve Act was in 1913.
Is it safe to say that nobody in 1913 contemplated that your small little group of people would decide to hand out $500 billion to foreigners? Well, I'm asking you if your agency has, in fact, according to Bloomberg, extended $9 trillion in credit, which, by the way, works out to $30,000 for every single man, woman, and child in this country. You're the Inspector General. I'd like to know, if you're not responsible for investigating that, who is?
In terms of who's responsible for investigating, would you mind repeating the question one more time?
What have you done to investigate the off-balance sheet transactions conducted by the Federal Reserve, which, according to Bloomberg, now total $9 trillion in the last 8 months.
I'm not, I don't know if I have actually seen that particular
Mr.
one.
Chairman, my time is up, but I have to tell you honestly, I am shocked to find out that nobody at the Federal Reserve, including the Inspector General, is keeping track of this.
The market is overwhelmed. I believe some of you used that term, or somebody did. I think it is overwhelmed by greed, by mismanagement. And the bottom line, as I see it, you're visiting the taxpayer with it. I think that's shameful myself.
Wall Street didn't care one bit what it was doing to neighborhoods. It didn't see the devastation. It didn't feel the pain. Do you think Wall Street owes the American people an apology?
Let me just say this. People on Main Street who think that Wall Street is somewhere far away and has whatever happens there has no implications for their lives are just misinformed, because if Wall Street, credit markets freeze up.
People know that what happens on Wall Street has an effect on their lives. That's not the question. The question is, does Wall Street owe the American people an apology?
Wall Street itself is a abstraction. There are many people who made big mistakes. We need to figure out what those were and make sure they don't happen again.
Senator Paulson, you know, there's a lot of blame to go around, a lot of blame, and a lot of blame. You know, I share the outrage that people have. It's embarrassing to look at this, and I think it's embarrassing for the United States of America.